यू.
थैंक यू थैंक यू.
यस
पर यार सर, यार सर,
हाँ डॉक्टर जसलीन एंड आई एम हियर.
यस यस मैम, यस मैम.
आई एम
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम, गुड
कोचेयरिंग.
मॉर्निंग
यस,
मैम.
गुड मॉर्निंग.
ओके, जस्ट वेटिंग. परिहार सर इज आल्सो देयर मैम. आई एम वेटिंग
यस सर.
सर.
लेट्स लेट्स स्टार्ट सर.
हाँ, परिहार सर इज देयर. अलका पांडे मैम इज देयर.
यस
अलका मैम. यस
यस यस एंड
एंड परिहार सर. सो वी
कैन
कैन
स्टार्ट.
स्टार्ट द सेशन.
यस यस, वी कैन स्टार्ट.
ओके, द फर्स्ट प्रेजेंटेशन इज डॉक्टर वंशज राज. इज देयर FP215 डॉक्टर वंशज राज. डॉक्टर सोमा मंडल, रेणुका श्रीनिवासन.
No, no, these are the co-authors.
Yeah, ma'am. Dr. Partha Mandal.
Yes, I'm there. Should I start?
Dr. Partha, now please start, because Dr. Mansraj Rai is there. No.
Fine.
So, sir, we are starting with the second presenter, Dr. Partha Mandal. Dr. Partha, please start.
Yes, 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 sir. Hello.
Yes, yes, yes.
Good morning.
ये वही वही कर रहे हैं सर अभी. मैंने अभी दीपक सर को भी रिक्वेस्ट किया है हमारा ऑल.
प्लीज म्यूट योरसेल्फ्स.
रिक्वेस्ट म्यूट योरसेल्फ्स.
Should I start?
Yes, yes, yes. Dr. Partha, please start.
Yeah. Good morning, viewers. My work is on paraoperative factors influencing the outcome of trabeculectomy in primary glaucoma. The paraoperative factors are the factors which were noticed and can be modified at the time of trabeculectomy. The outcome is defined as the intraocular pressure reaching target intraocular pressure or lower without any anti-glaucoma medications and persisted for at least 1 year. All were included as primary open angle glaucoma and primary angle closure glaucoma without any identifiable secondary cause for raised intraocular pressure. The purpose is to identify relationship between the factors to successful outcome. It was a retrospective non-comparative case series. The studies were included primary glaucoma underwent trabeculectomy where the indications were failure to reach target intraocular pressure with maximum anti-glaucoma drops. Secondary glaucoma accessory intervention like cataract surgery or the blepharic revision and follow-up not more than 1 year were excluded. Three methodologies. First, the review of operative videos. Out of 179 videos, 105 were selected. We made an educational video demonstrating all factors with variation and sent to 8 other consultants. 5 randomly selected videos sent to all 8 consultants and asked to evaluate 9 factors with variability. Evaluating agreement statistics, 5 consultants out of the 8 were selected with best kappa value, and all the 5 consultants evaluated ultimately the 105 videos for all 9 factors with variability. The paraoperative factors evaluated were conjunctival status, conjunctival dissection, tenons thickness, tenons status, tenons disinsertion, amount of scleral cautery, use of mitomycin, duration of mitomycin, whether the use of mitomycin was according to previous plan or not, scleral flap thickness, scleral edge cautery, making of ostium with blade or punch, ostium size and distance of conjunctival suture line from the apex of triangular flap. Statistics were done by SPSS software. The surgeries were broken into 2 groups, successful and the failure, and demographic observational data by chi-square test and t-square test, and all the statistics were conducted at 5% level of significance. Mainly the Cox proportional hazard regression analysis was performed in the backward stepwise method to find out the significant risk factors, and those factors having less than 0.05 significance were again studied by the Kaplan-Meier survival analysis with Mantel-Cox log rank test. By both these tests, if the statistical significance was less than 0.05, then it were concluded to be the significant factors. These were the results. Out of 105, 82 were in successful group and 23 were in the failure group. The average follow-up was 28.7 months and the average age was 48.8. This is the result mainly. This is for the Cox proportional hazard regression analysis, and this was confirmed with the Mantel Cox log rank test. The four factors like spongy tenons, mild cautery, ostium making with the blade, and ostium size of 1/3 of the base of the flap, these four factors were significant with a statistical significance. And these four factors were evaluated by the Mantel Cox log rank test, where the two factors, mild cautery and the ostium with blade, were significant. But if you see the relative risk in case of the ostium with the blade, it was less than 0.5. So this is a negative, to some extent, the negative factors, like if the ostiums are made with the blade, there's less chance of success. So in conclusion, minimal cautery and the creation of ostium with the blade are the significant paraoperative factors for the outcome of filtration surgery in the primary glaucoma. The limitations of our study, the target intraocular pressure, there was no fixed formula, but the possible explanation is target based on the factors which are applied for every eyes. And the grading of factors with variability depends on the consultant discretion, but we try to standardize by educating them with an educational video. In some situations, change of duration of MMC because of some paraoperative conditions, but all considered use of mitomycin, whether according to the preoperative plan or not, as a factor, but it came out to be insignificant. The another limitations were the somehow the factors were not randomized exactly, like the ostium made with the blade or punch. On search by the internet, we could not find any similar study relating surgical outcome to the paraoperative factors of trabeculectomy. Studies relating to duration of mitomycin C with surgical outcome existed, but in our study, it was not a significant factor. Probably it may be due to multivariate analysis. The significant factors came out to be minimal cautery and the creation of ostium with surgical blade. Minimal cautery, the possible explanation, thermal cautery incites fibrosis, which is detrimental for successful filtration blade. And in case of the creation of ostium with the surgical blade, maybe it increases the inflammation resulting from more manipulation and subsequent underfiltration because it decreases the success. In another way, it may be decision of making ostium with the blade or punch was not randomized, and trabeculectomy with ostium made with surgical blades have the longer follow-ups when we just reviewed our results. Extrapolation of our study, it may be to get the better success in trabeculectomy, cautery should be applied as less as possible, so the minimized preoperative medications, which increases congestion, so thereby decreasing the cautery needed. And to decrease the inflammation, less manipulation is necessary in making the ostium. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.
You did not take into consideration what flaps were made?
All the ostium were made by the triangular scleral flap. The similar. It's all.
Okay.
Any question from any judges? Jaslyn, ma'am.
Did you also take into consideration the preoperative IOP, in considering the success of AU?
No, madam, all the
percentage reduction.
And your voice is cracking.
We have taken those cases where the target intraocular pressure was not achieved with maximum medication. So the immediately before operation with maximum medication, intraocular pressure was not considered, ma'am.
Anyone else has any questions? Or we move on to the next speaker.
We can move to next presentation, ma'am. Next is Dr. Vansraj Rai. First presentation, hello, Dr. Vansraj Rai.
Hello, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah. Please proceed.
Sir, our slides are visible.
Yes, Dr. Vansraj. Yes.
Good morning, all. My name is Dr. Vanshaj Rai. My topic of presentation is comparison of diurnal intraocular pressure measurement, eye care home tonometer, with cold vein applanation. Cold vein applanation tonometer in a tertiary eye care hospital in South India. Introduction. As known, diurnal variation of IOP is an independent risk factor for development and progression of glaucoma. There are various tonometers available. Cold vein applanation tonometer, which is based on Imbert-Fick principle, is the gold standard for measuring intraocular pressure. It is associated with certain drawbacks, such as it needs topical anesthesia, has long learning curve, and needs slit lamp for examination. Whereas eye care home tonometer, which is based on rebound tonometry, doesn't require topical anesthesia and slit lamp. It has less learning curve, thus easy to learn and use. Eye care home tonometer is held at a distance of 3 to 10 mm from the unanesthetized eye. A solenoid magnetized probe in the instrument is propelled against the eye, impacts, and then rebounds from the cornea. This is how we can measure the IOP by eye care home tonometer. The purpose of this study was to compare the diurnal IOP self-measured by patients themselves using eye care home tonometer with IOP measured by glaucoma specialist using cold vein applanation tonometer in office hours. Primary objectives were to analyze the difference in diurnal IOP variation measured by GAT done by glaucoma specialist and eye care home tonometer done by patients themselves during office hours in newly diagnosed patient of primary open angle glaucoma, normal tension glaucoma, and ocular hypertension, and to compare the effect of video assisted versus verbal manual training of patient for using eye care home tonometer on IOP readings. Secondary objectives were to study the diurnal variation of IOP within different categories of glaucoma and to study the influence of central corneal thickness on eye care home tonometer readings. This study was performed at glaucoma services of Aravind Eye Hospital, Pondicherry, and newly diagnosed patients of POAG, NTG, OST, and already diagnosed patients of NTG and OST who were on monotherapy were recruited. Standard definitions of POAG, NTG, and OST were used in the study. Patients of age 40 to 70 years, newly diagnosed patients of POAG, NTG, OST, already diagnosed patients of NTG and OST who were on anti-glaucoma medication monotherapy after standard washout of anti-glaucoma medication, minimum education qualification of patients completed matriculation, and patients who were willing to give written informed consent were included in the study. The standard washout period of beta blockers and alpha agonists is 3 weeks and of prostaglandin analogs is of 4 weeks. Patients having glaucoma other than POAG, NTG, OSG, patients underwent any surgical laser procedure in the study eye except cataract surgery. Patient having corneal abnormalities such as opacities, scars, dystrophy, history of recurrent aberration in the study eye. Newly diagnosed patients of POAG and NTG who have vertical cup disc ratio more than 0.8 and astigmatism more than or equal to 3 diopter were excluded from the study. Methodology. Newly diagnosed patients of POAG, NTG, OST, and already diagnosed patients of OST and NTG who were on monotherapy were recruited and underwent preliminary examination, which is done by glaucoma specialist, and dilated fundus examination, which is done by masked glaucoma specialist by slit lamp biomicroscopy with plus 90D lens. Diagnosis of POAG, NTG, OST confirmed and patients recruited for the study after counseling. Already diagnosed patients of NTG, OST who were recruited after standard anti-glaucoma medication washout and counseling was done. Study date was assigned to the patients and those who were unable to reach the hospital at 7:30 a.m. were admitted 1 day prior to date of study. Written informed consent was obtained. Training to use eye care home tonometer was given to the patient. And patient were divided randomly into two categories, one in which patient got verbal training and other in which patient got video assisted training of eye care home tonometer. IOP is measured by Goldman Appellation tonometer and eye care home tonometer 5 times a day at interval of 15 minutes. Diurnal variation of IOP done by Goldman Appellation tonometer was assessed by an independent masked glaucoma consultant and standard treatment given to the patient. Finally, findings were compiled in a pro forma and analysis was done. Statistical analysis data was expressed in mean plus minus standard deviation and as percentage. Categorical variables were assessed by using chi-square test. IOP values were analyzed using pair t-test. Agreement between tonometers was tested using intra-class correlation. P-value less than 0.05 was considered as statistically significant. All the statistical analysis was performed by statistical software Stata 14.0.
Dr. Vansraj, kindly conclude the result. Time is up.
So 21 patients of POAG were recruited and 26 patients of OHT were recruited and four patients of NTG was participated in the study and the study was done in both the eye.
Our study shows
good positive correlation between the gold standard Goldman Appellation tonometer and eye care home tonometer during office hours in all the three categories of glaucoma.
Thank you. Judges, thanks, questions, sir. Please. If anyone wish to ask any question.
Dr. Vanshesh, do you think this eye care tonometer can replace the Goldman tonometer based on your study?
Yes, ma'am, it can replace. But in my study, we recruited less number of patients due to corona pandemic. So for better understanding and validation, we can do a study by taking more sample size.
Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Raj Rai.
Thank you, sir.
Next presentation is of Dr. Mahesh. Dr. Mahesh Bharti. Not present.
Dr. Mahesh is not present.
Okay. Dr. Vaibhav Kumar Jain.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Vaibhav, please.
Good morning to all of you. My presentation is on steroid-induced glaucoma after kidney transplant patients. So coming to introduction, the chronic kidney disease globally, it poses a significant morbidity and mortality. The prevalence of CKD has been estimated as 800 per million population according to an estimate. And incidence of end-stage renal disease has been estimated as 150 to 200 per million population according to an estimate, which require kidney transplant and or dialysis. So coming to kidney transplant and immunosuppression, kidney transplantation is a treatment of choice for patients with end-stage renal disease. However, these patients require prolonged immunosuppression, and it is the key for it is a major key for successful transplantation. So these immunosuppressants are largely comprised of systemic steroid, cyclosporin, tacrolimus, mycophenolate, mofetil, azathioprine. Immunosuppressants are associated with a lot of adverse effects, including ophthalmological manifestations. So there have been very few studies showing the pattern of steroid-induced glaucoma in patients with kidney transplant recipient, particularly from India. So our aim was to provide the incidence of steroid-induced glaucoma in these patients and also the treatment characteristic in these patients receiving kidney transplant. Also, we studied the other ophthalmological finding in these patients. So coming to method, it was a cross-sectional study. So we did the prospective enrollment of patients who underwent kidney transplantation, and these were on routine follow-up at nephrology department of our institute. The study was conducted for 1 year, and necessary clearances were obtained for this study. So coming to immunosuppression regimen, all patients received in the induction regimen injection methylprednisolone. And the maintenance regimen was comprised of steroid, tacrolimus, and mycophenolate. So all patients underwent comprehensive ophthalmic evaluation, including slit lamp biomicroscopy, IOP with Goldman applanation tonometer. And we assessed the number of patients with glaucoma. So cases with intraocular pressure more than 21 millimeter mercury associated with visual field defect, optic disc cupping or asymmetry of 0.2 or more. Ocular hypertension was designated as patients with intraocular pressure more than 21 millimeter of mercury with normal visual field. Also, the other ocular disorders were noted in these patients. So coming to statistical, we also did a relationship between doses, duration, and number of days with high dose steroid, and association of these with cataract and ocular hypertension and glaucoma was also studied using necessary tests. Coming to results, so we had 72 patients in which the mean age was 39 year approximately, and the males were more common as compared to females. The mean follow-up was 30 months. And coming to etiology, so diabetic nephropathy was the most common cause of chronic kidney disease or end-stage renal disease in our patients. Next was the chronic glomerulonephritis and the rest one, the tubular interstitial nephritis and idiopathic. So steroid-induced glaucoma was seen in 7 patients. It was around 9.72%. Ocular hypertension was seen in 9 patients. And the cataract was the most common complication we have seen in around 30 patients. That was around 41.67%. So rest were the hypertensive retinopathy, diabetic retinopathy, and branching retinal vein occlusion. Coming to treatment characteristic, 3 patients received anti-glaucoma medication to control intraocular pressure. 4 patients required trabeculectomy for further control of intraocular pressure. Now coming to relation of steroid doses and glaucoma. So the total dose was significantly higher in patients who developed glaucoma and ocular hypertension and cataract as compared to patients who did not develop these complications. Also, the number of days were significantly higher. The patients who received high dose steroid for days and as compared to patients who did not develop glaucoma or cataract complication. Now coming to discussion. So we reported ocular complications in around 50% of patients with kidney transplant. This was similar to a case series from India, which also reported the incidence of ocular abnormality in 52.5% patients. The incidence of cataract in our series, the cataract was the most common complication encountered in around 41.67% of patients. So the incidence of cataract has varied from 23 to 62.5% in various earlier series. Now coming to ocular hypertension, it was the next most common steroid-related ophthalmic complication. It was encountered in 12.5% patients. This was similar to another previous study was Simeu et al. And a high incidence of ocular hypertension has also been reported in around 47% of patients in a series of 15 patients receiving kidney transplant recipient. Now coming to glaucoma, we had 7 patients with steroid-induced glaucoma in which visual field defects were also there. And another recently published 10-year analysis of eyesight, which reported incidence of glaucoma 16%. So coming to conclusion, kidney transplant recipient must be screened periodically for any ophthalmic complication as their timely intervention can preserve or improve the vision. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Vaibhav.
Thank you,
sir. Judges, questions, please. Welcome, ma'am.
Dr. Vaibhav,
do you think
this rise in pressure after steroid use is reversible after the steroids are stopped, or every patient will ultimately go on to get a trabeculectomy or any surgery for that matter?
Ma'am, we have seen in some patients it is reversible, because if you lower down the doses of steroid, the pressure comes down in some patients. But in advanced cases, it is generally irreversible, so you require ultimate. Mostly patients are on low dose steroid, receiving kidney transplant patient after 6 months to 1 year. They are on around 10 mg or 5 mg of steroid mostly.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr.
Vaibhav. Those patients who needed a surgery and all, they were diagnosed late or this was inadvertent?
Mostly patients, ma'am, they were on the, though we have not analyzed the cause of this thing, but mostly they were on the high doses of steroid and also presented late to us.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vaibhav. Next presentation is of Dr. Shalini Singh. Dr. Shalini.
Good morning, all of you. I am presenting my topic, angle closure disease in rural central India, a hospital-based clinical epidemiological study. I have no financial disclosure. Primary angle closure disease is a protean disease with significantly high incidence worldwide as well as in India. Incidence and prevalence of primary angle closure disease varies with geographical variations, demographic profiles, and methodology used. The purpose of our study is to study the demographic and clinical profile of primary angle closure disease in a rural-based tertiary care center of central India. This was the prospective cross-sectional study. 244 patients were included and 468 eyes were included in this. The patient was diagnosed as a case of primary angle closure disease on the basis of International Society of Geographical and Epidemiological Ophthalmology classification. Outcome measures included were age, sex, subtypes of primary angle closure disease, intraocular pressure, and management of disease. Result of our study showed that the mean age was around 53 years. Our study showed the mainly the male predominance, around 66% population was male. As we see, the primary angle closure glaucoma is the most common subtype seen in our study, followed by primary angle closure and primary angle closure suspect. The highest mean IOP was seen in group of primary angle closure patients, followed by primary angle closure glaucoma and primary angle closure suspect. There was statistically significant difference between the mean IOP of these three groups. Patients were managed medically, surgically, and laser peripheral iridotomy was done. Total 468 eyes were taken and maximum eyes were undergone laser peripheral iridotomy procedure, followed by medical management and followed by surgical management. Only 15 patients were undergone phacotrabeculectomy procedure. We have seen that while most of the studies were carried out in urban and semi-urban population, rural population is rarely examined. Although there are some studies
which have covered the rural population, but they are mainly based on eastern rural population or south Indian rural population or north Indian rural population. In our study, we have tried to cover the central rural Indian population in our tertiary center. In this, we have tried to elaborate the demographic variability of patients with Paul et al. And Vijay et al. The Paul et al. Has covered mainly the eastern rural Indian population, and then Vijay et al. They have mainly covered the rural South Indian population. In our study, we have seen that mostly patients came in fifth decade, around 53 years age group. And in eastern population, patients mainly present with in sixth decade. Our study showed that there is mainly male predominance, while in eastern population and south Indian population, the ratio is either equal or there is mainly female predominance. Highest mean IOP was seen in our study. It was around 29 mmHg. We have also tried to compare the prevalence of primary angle closure disease, and in we have seen that our patient came with primary angle closure glaucoma around 50% patient of our study came with diagnosis of primary angle closure glaucoma, while in the Chennai glaucoma study, which have covered mainly the rural South Indian population, patient were diagnosed as primary angle closure suspect. So in our study, we have tried to patternize the angle closure disease, and we have seen that most commonly subtype with which the patient has presented as attack of angle closure glaucoma, and these patients were managed. Thank you.
So, would you think that a screening of the population would be very useful, considering that they are presenting with the glaucoma?
Sorry, ma'am, I cannot listen to you. Sorry, ma'am, can you please repeat that question, ma'am?
Yes. Do you think screening is recommended based on your findings of the population?
Yes, ma'am. Screening is very much recommended in all the rural patients in rural population of all the area. Like there is geographical variation is present and demographical variation is also present. So we have mainly covered the fourth decade, fifth decade, and sixth decade or seventh decade population, and we should also cover the rural population. The patient who are coming to us with the complaint of diminution of vision or other complaints, it can also be an incidental finding also. So we are recommending to screen the patients.
So do you usually do a gonioscopy in most of your OPD patients?
Ma'am, if the patient is of fifth decade, sixth decade or elder, then we look for the disc, and if we suspect and we do the Goldman applanation tonometry, and if we suspect that the gonioscopy is needed, then we perform it.
Okay. So
ideally, for the angle closure, it is. Yeah, ma'am, please continue.
Ji, sir.
Yes. Ideally, you should be, doing it as a screening technique also.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Dr. Shalini, your study is a hospital-based study, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
So how did you segregate the rural population based on the address of the patient? I mean, how did you see that these were the rural patients? I mean, you didn't go out into the village and screen the patients, right? So it's, it was a hospital-based study. So how did you say this is a rural population paper?
Ma'am, actually this study is from the Safai Medical College, which is actually covering the rural population. Mostly the patient that come to the patient came to that hospital are based on the rural population. And yes, we also use this, that like address was taken, and then we can we do this.
Okay,
thank you, Dr. Shalini. Next presentation is by Dr. Ruchi Shukla. Dr. Ruchi is present?
No, I think she's not present, sir.
Okay. Then we can go for Dr. Tapesh Nag. Dr. Tapesh?
I think he is also not present.
Okay. Then next, Karthikeyan. Dr. Karthikeyan?
Yes, sir. I am present, sir.
Yeah, please present.
Is my screen visible?
Yes, yes, Dr.
Good morning to everyone. My topic is raised intraocular pressure in thyroid-associated ophthalmopathy, non-responsiveness, and paradoxical association with glaucoma progression. No conflicts of interest and no financial interest. The causes for raised IOP in thyroid-associated ophthalmopathy include accumulation of glycosaminoglycans in trabecular meshwork, increase in episcleral venous pressure and orbital pressure, responsiveness to steroid administered for treatment of TAO, and gaze-related restrictive myopathy. The various management options include glaucoma medication, selective laser trabecular opacity, glaucoma filtration study, surgery, and treatment of TAO with steroids or orbital decompression. We aim to assess the responsiveness of glaucoma therapy and the association of IOP with glaucoma progression. We included the patients with TAO defined by the following criteria who are having IOP more than 21 millimeter of mercury. We excluded patients with other forms of glaucoma. We defined responders as eyes in which IOP normalized after glaucoma medication or laser trabeculoplasty, and eyes in which IOP was not controlled with maximum tolerable glaucoma medication and required surgery for IOP control were termed as non-responders. We analyzed the progression of the patient which had minimum of 2 years follow-up based on cup-disc ratio and visual field. Results, we had 42 eyes of 21 patients with mean age of 43.8 years at similar sex ratio and mean baseline IOP of 28 millimeter of mercury, and 30 eyes had ocular hypertension, 12 eyes had glaucoma. Among this, 15 of 42 eyes, that is one third of the patient, were responders, and 23 of 42 eyes were non-responders. 4 eyes with less than IOP less than 25 mm of mercury with only ocular hypertension were just observed without glaucoma medications. Among the non-responders, 3 eyes Chad underwent glaucoma filtration surgery. 2 eyes further required orbital decompression because of the poor eye control. And out of the 8 eyes which underwent orbital decompression, 6 eyes had a normalized intraocular pressure. By comparing the progressor with responders versus non-responders, male non-responders had a male predominance and had a higher number of patients in uncontrolled thyroid state and had a higher baseline intraocular pressure and higher number of patients with proptosis. We assessed the correlated IOP control and glaucoma progression. 14 eyes of 7 patients which had less than 2 years follow-up were excluded from the progression analysis. 7 of 28 eyes, that is 25% of the eyes, showed glaucoma progression. Among them, 70% of the eyes had paradoxical association of IOP with glaucoma progression. That is, 50% did not show progression of the IOP, progression with high IOP over a median period of 36 months. And 6 eyes showed glaucoma progression despite adequate IOP control. We need to know about the intraorbital pressure, which is can be measured by venous outflow pressure. The difference between venous outflow pressure and intraocular pressure should be less than 5 millimeter of mercury to maintain the optic disc perfusion. If the difference is more, then the optic disc perfusion is compromised. It can lead to development of scotomas. Since the primary pathology in TAO is raised intraocular pressure or intraorbital pressure, raised IOP is often refractory to management. The risk factors for poor response to glaucoma therapy in TAO patients include male gender, higher baseline IOP, uncontrolled thyroid state, and presence of proptosis. If indicated, addressing the episcleral venous pressure by orbital decompression should be considered before going for any glaucoma surgery. Once we get a TAO patient raised IOP, we must start with safely tolerable glaucoma medication. If there is no baseline visual field defect, we have to just follow up for changes. When there is progression or when there is a baseline visual field defect, we might go for treatment of TAO or orbital decompression. And later on, if needed, we will do glaucoma surgery. Conclusions: glaucoma / ocular hypertension in TAO does not behave like other primary open angle glaucoma. Despite high incidence of therapeutic non-responders in patients with raised IOP, optic disc progression is rare. Maintaining the optic disc perfusion is more important than reducing IOP for preventing glaucoma progression. Stringent IOP reduction should be considered only in patients where progression is documented with high IOP. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Karthikeyan. Dr. Judges, questions, please. Anyone wish to ask any question? Dr. Alka, Dr. Jasleen, Pariyar, sir.
Okay, Dr. Karthikeyan, do you think that drugs which actually affect the episcleral venous pressure would be more helpful in thyroid-induced glaucoma?
Drugs affect...
Like the ROCK inhibitors, for example?
That also goes through the trabecular meshwork, ma'am.
Okay.
But we have not tried ROCK inhibitors because it has been recently available in India. So we have not tried in this. But that also... It acts from the trabecular meshwork. Episcleral venous pressure is addressed because of the glycosaminoglycans glycans and all other inflammatory things. I don't think it will have any effect. I'm not sure, ma'am. We have to try.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
What is your experience of measuring the intraocular pressure in these patients with thyroid? Because even the technique of measuring can make a difference.
Yes, ma'am. They have a gaze-related intraocular pressure. So if the patient have restriction of in any case, you have to keep the eye in that position and take them.
In the primary position?
In primary position, if there is not in the primary position, in the position where the eye
position
of the
position of rest. Okay. Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Malingam. Next presentation is by Dr. Shalini Mohan. Dr. Shalini Mohan.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak. Good morning.
Yes,
good morning, respected judges. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Thank you so much. So, good morning, respected judges, and I'm going to present my study, Effect of Valsalva Maneuver on Ocular Blood Flow Parameters. I don't have any financial interest. We know that Valsalva Maneuver is being frequently performed during daily activities, including heavy weight lifting, vomiting, straining, forceful coughing, and sneezing. Now, when we see various phases of Valsalva maneuver, it has been seen that there is rise in intraocular pressure, and this is a recently published study in European Journal of Ophthalmology, which was a UBM study on 76 patients of primary angle closure glaucoma, where there was rise in intraocular pressure from 19 to 29, and there was narrowing of angle on UBM. Now, we know that vascular theory of glaucoma says that abnormal perfusion and subsequent ischemia of optic nerve head plays a major role in glaucometer's damage. And autoregulation is important for maintaining ocular perfusion pressure. Any change in ocular blood pressure due to increasing IOP, fluctuating blood pressure, resulting into decreased ocular perfusion pressure results into damage to retinal ganglion cells and subsequent glaucometer's optic neuropathy. So keeping these points in mind, when we searched the literature, we found that there was no study which has actually studied the ocular blood flow velocity in glaucoma patients and ocular hypertensive patients who were performing Valsalva maneuver. Therefore, this study was done with the aim to study the effect of Valsalva maneuver on ocular blood flow parameters by color Doppler in normal patients, patients of primary open-angle glaucoma and ocular hypertensives. This was a cross-sectional study done at a tertiary care eye center. The ethics approval was done. Three cohorts of glaucoma patients were selected, POAG 32 in number, ocular hypertensives 27, and healthy control. Healthy control were 36 in number. Am I audible?
Request everybody else to please be on mute.
Yes. Yes, Dr. Sunny, you are audible.
Thank
you. People kindly
exclusion criteria. Exclusion criteria were these: advanced glaucoma were excluded. Detailed history and examination was done. Intraocular pressure was checked with Perkins handheld tonometer while patient was lying down in supine position pre and post and during Valsalva and post Valsalva. Gonioscopy Humphreys visual field was done. Valsalva maneuver was done by blowing into manometer till 40 millimeters of mercury for 15 seconds for each arterial measurement. Color Doppler was done on a M-turbo ultrasound system. And so this was the way we did color Doppler. We can see central retinal artery at anterior part of the optic nerve head, and short posterior ciliary arteries were seen just next to the optic nerve head. And this is the central retinal artery, short posterior ciliary artery, and ophthalmic artery in relation to the recti muscle. And then sample volume cursor was put at the blood flow. And we can see this graph. The peak of the graph is peak systolic velocity. The smallest possible raise is the end diastolic velocity, and resistivity index was automatically calculated by the machine. So these are the various arteries in which we study these three parameters. Now here we can see that when patient was not doing Valsalva, the peak systolic velocity was 11.8 millimeters of mercury. And as the patient started doing Valsalva, we can see the peak systolic velocity reduced to 9.88 centimeter per second. And this was done for central retinal artery, for ophthalmic artery, and for short posterior ciliary arteries. Now here we can see when Valsalva was being performed, this is the peak systolic velocity, which is 7.7. And as the Valsalva was released, it increased to 12.3. So statistical analysis was done by pair t-test to compare between the variables. Spearman correlation coefficient was also calculated. Now these are my results. We can see that maximum patients were in the age group of 41 to 50 years, and males were predominant. When we calculated the mean deviation, average of the mean deviation, it was minus 6.5 decibels in POAG, minus 1.14 in OHT, and in controls, it was minus 1.45. Now, these are the ocular blood flow parameters. We can see the mean ocular blood flow parameters were minimal for POAG patients in comparison to ocular hypertensives than control in all the three arteries. And similarly, end diastolic velocity was least for primary open angle glaucoma. Now, this is slightly busy looking table, but there were so many parameters for each artery. When we see that peak systolic velocity was seen to reduce significantly, the p-values were highly significant for all the three arteries in POAG patient. Similarly, end diastolic velocity also reduced to highly significant levels and resistivity index increased to highly significant level during Valsalva in all the patients. In ocular hypertensives also, there was increase in peak systolic velocity and diastolic. There was decrease in peak systolic velocity and diastolic velocity and increase in resistivity index. And same were the parameters in controls also. When we tried to calculate the Spearman correlation coefficient, we could find a negative correlation between the end diastolic velocity and short posterior ciliary velocity and mean deviation of the visual field. Now, the p-value was again significant for this correlation. Therefore, lesser was the breadth to velocity, more negative the mean deviation of the visual field was. So, in our study, we found that there were lower blood velocities as compared to control and ocular hypertensives. There was rise in intraocular pressure in all the groups to a significant level. Now, there was significant rise in resistivity index in all the arteries, suggesting that there is a reduced flow inside the arteries while doing Valsalva maneuver. Now, this was the only
study. Kindly conclude, time is up.
Yeah, this is last slide. This was the only study which has studied pulsatile ocular blood flow in normal patients, but no study in glaucoma patients. To conclude, I will say that Valsalva-like maneuvers lead to increase in IOP and reduce ocular blood flow parameters. A negative correlation is found between end diastolic velocity and mean deviation. So recommendation was drawn that these kind of maneuvers should be avoided in the patients of pre-primary open angle glaucoma and ocular hypertension. Thank you so much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Dr. Shalini. Judges, questions? Alka ma'am, Jasleen ma'am, Pariyar sir. Any question for Dr. Shanli?
Do we have more author, these presenters now?
Any presenter left for the presentation?
Sir, I am...
Dr. Ruchi Shukla, Dr. Partha Mandal, Dr. Partha Mandal has presented, Dr. Mahesh Bhartia,
who's remaining? Anyone who's remaining?
Dr. Pratibha, sir.
Dr. Pratibha, please wait. I'm just checking the initial three who are
Dr. Mahesh Bharti.
Dr. Mahesh Bharti is not present, sir.
Because he's number three.
Yes, he's not present.
And Dr. Ruchi Shukla.
She's also not present, sir.
And
Dr. Tapesh Nag.
Dr. Kamal. Subramaniam?
He presented, sir. Kamal Subramaniam is good.
Yeah, Tapesh Nag. Dr. Tapesh Nag.
Tapesh Nag.
No, I think he's not there.
He's not there, sir.
Dr. Pratibha Devi Niven.
I am there, sir.
Okay. He has the keynote address.
Okay. So for competitive session, there is no one.
Yes.
Our time is up to 10:55, so we can go with the keynote address now.
Yes. Dr. Pratibha, please start.
Yes, sir. Is my slide seen, sir?
Yes, we can see your slide and we can also hear you properly. Yes, okay. Thank you. Just do the full screen.
Yes, sir. Good morning, everyone. So I'm presenting my free paper, which I presented in AOS 2020, a comparative study on the effect of dorzolamide 2% versus timolol 0.5% on ocular blood flow in normal tension glaucoma patients. So glaucoma is a progressive condition characterized by progressive retinal ganglion cell death and visual field loss, in which elevated intraocular pressure is not the only risk factor. There are other causes like ischemia to optic nerve and dysfunctional vascular regulation, which plays a major role in progression of glaucoma. In normal tension glaucoma, literature has given enough evidence saying that IOP independent factors predominate for the progression, which includes vascular insufficiency, vasospasm, and low intracranial pressure. This is a typical picture of a glaucomatous disc with RNFL defect and a corresponding field change. In 2007, the World Glaucoma Consensus have reported that a lower ocular perfusion pressure, a lower ocular blood flow, and a vascular dysfunction can cause progression in glaucoma. With all these previous reports and literature, it has been understood that retrobulbar hemodynamics plays a very important role in the progression of glaucoma. And that retrobulbar hemodynamics can be assessed by various ways, both invasive and non-invasive, among which color Doppler imaging is one technique which is very efficient in giving a good knowledge about the retrobulbar hemodynamics. And it has been linked to C for glaucoma progression and visual field loss. Color Doppler imaging was done by the GE Sono CT ultrasound system with a 7.5 megahertz linear probe in our hospital. And color Doppler imaging was done in the ophthalmic artery, central retinal artery, and short posterior ciliary artery. And the machine calculates the resistive index based on the peak systolic velocity and end diastolic velocity. And this resistive index is very important parameter in determining the progression of glaucoma. This is the picture of the machine which we use, and the machine calculates the peak systolic velocity and end diastolic velocity of ophthalmic artery, central retinal artery, and posterior ciliary arteries. Since we did not have a normative data at that time of our presentation, we did a small normative data from our population. We took healthy individuals of about 25 people, and we did we calculated the resistive index. And we found the resistive index values were significantly higher than the Western population. And the resistive index also seemed to increase with age. This is the picture of the color Doppler imaging, which the picture shows a peak and a trough. This is a picture of a glaucomatous eye, wherein the peak is blunted. And the resistive index seems to be high in this patient. So with this background, we aim to analyze the effects of dorzolamide and timolol on ocular blood flow with color Doppler imaging in normal tension glaucoma. It was a prospective study. It was a comparative double-blinded study. Neither the patient nor the radiologist who did the study. A single radiologist performed the procedure for our entire patients. Both of them were not aware of which drug they were taking into. And newly diagnosed normotensive patients were included in the study. A baseline glaucoma and an eye ocular examination and color Doppler imaging was done. The patients were given either dorzolamide or timolol 2 times a day for 12 weeks. The final measurement was done at the end of 12 weeks. Glaucoma evaluation and ocular blood flow was analyzed pre and post treatment. We included patients who were newly diagnosed to have a normal tension glaucoma. We included if their best corrected visual acuity was at least 20 by 40 in one night. And we also included patients who were willing for follow-up. We excluded patients with all other secondary glaucomas. We excluded patients who had systemic involvement, systemic problems, because they play a lot of role in the retrobulbar vasculature and they influence the blood flow. So we included patients with all these systemic parameters. And during our initial visit, we measured the systolic and diastolic blood pressure, pulse rate. We calculated the ocular perfusion pressure based on this formula. We did a thorough ocular examination, a field evaluation, and we did the color Doppler imaging. The patients were recruited in the glaucoma clinic. Medicines were started by the glaucoma consultant after the initial CVI measurement, and every alternate patient was given timolol. The final color Doppler imaging was done at 12 weeks. The study patients were basically divided into two groups, the timolol group and dorzolamide group. Timolol group, the baseline measurements were done, and after 12 weeks, the final was done, and similarly, it was followed for dorzolamide. We had 11 patients in timolol group and 11 in dorzolamide group, and this was the resistive index of the timolol and dorzolamide group in all the three arteries. In ophthalmic artery and central retinal artery, we did not find any significant reduction in the resistive index post-treatment. However, in the short posterior ciliary artery, we found a significant reduction in the resistive index in short posterior ciliary artery in the dorzolamide group. Coming on to discussion, the vascularization of outer zone of retina was directly dependent on posterior ciliary artery, which is a branch of ophthalmic artery. Circulatory insufficiency in posterior ciliary artery can directly affect the progression of glaucoma because it causes ischemia of the optic nerve. And that therefore, the velocities and resistive index of posterior ciliary artery is very significant for progression of glaucoma. It has been reported in literature that the ocular perfusion pressure is a risk factor for Sir, can I continue?
Kindly conclude your slide.
Sir, this is, I think it is not a competitive paper and I think 10 minutes is given. If I want to conclude, I'll conclude.
Okay, you can continue for.
Okay, sir. It has been reported in literature that the decrease in ocular perfusion pressure is a risk factor for progression, and decrease in flow velocities and increase in resistive index can cause progression of glaucoma. Therefore, color Doppler imaging can prognosticate the progression of glaucoma. Kaiser et al. Have reported that normal tension glaucoma has been influenced by the retrobulbar hemodynamics. 72% of the published studies shows that dorzolamide increases the blood flow. They report that the dorzolamide is improving the blood flow by extracellular acidosis or selective inhibition of CAI inhibitor. However, our data did not show a significant reduction in resistive index in all the arteries except short posterior ciliary artery. Rankin et al. Also had a similar result as our study. But the main limitation of our study was a short follow-up period. And to conclude, perfusion of optic nerve head is directly related to retrobulbar circulation. Resistive index can be a prognosticative marker. And this study shows that timolol and dorzolamide shows a significant difference in ocular perfusion pressure and intraocular pressure. And dorzolamide significantly improves the end diastolic velocity in the short posterior ciliary artery. And we had published this in and have written a chapter. Thank you so much for allowing me to present.
Thank you, Dr. Pratibha. So before we conclude the session, we again request if anyone who has left and present, every people kindly again make a call. Dr. Mahesh Bharti, I am going to mark him absent. All the judges kindly note that Dr. Mahesh Bharti is not present. His serial number is 3. Then Dr. Ruchi Shukla, she is also not present. And Dr. Tapesh Nag. These 3 are the absentees in our session. Every people?
Noted.
Noted. Okay. All judges, it is requested, everyone is knowing where to send the mark sheet so that scientific committee will get, and we have to send it within 10 minutes.
Yeah, I already sent.
Yes, ma'am. Welcome, ma'am, you want to say anything?
No.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, ma'am.
Who is the?
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.